Hi, I'm Paul Tyler, and welcome to another episode of the Reimagine Podcast. Laura, how are you?
I'm doing well. It's great to be back, Paul.
It is. And we've got a really interesting guest and who's a CEO of a company that's done very well in our space. Do you want to do the introductions?
Absolutely. So with us today here is Tim Bonacy, President and CEO of Luma Financial Technologies. And we're excited to have the conversation around the retirement space and what Luma's been up to and where we think it might be holding in the future. So Tim, with that, do you mind, you know, introducing yourself a little bit? Talk to us about Luma, the work that you do, and just give the listeners a little bit about your background.
Sure. Happy to. I've been, grew up mostly in the wealth management industry as background. So working with investment management, trust, annuity products, securities products, with that, some of the higher net worth clients and mass affluence for a very long time. So while we're now in the fintech space, I really grew up through the product space and working with the clients and directly and understand that side of the business. So where we are now, that, as you know, that industries are evolving and changing all the time, and the technology part of it, how you deliver that information to clients, has become much more critical. So my background, really worked in the super regional banks throughout the Midwest, and then launched Luma inside of my company that I started in 2005 that was providing those products to clients. We built an internal technology to make it easier for our clients to use, and eventually realized in 2018 that technology really should be standalone. We spun it out onto its own, and really have seen just a significant adoption of the technology, and as we hopefully hope to drive more adoption of the product set as well.
And Tim, tell us who's your ideal customer, or who is your typical customer today?
Yeah, we're a B2B platform from a user standpoint, so it's really going to all the advisors, and we do look at advisors in several different channels, right? So we work with advisors that are inside big private banks and the wirehouses, advisors that are in registered investment advisor RIAs, bank broker-dealers, independent broker-dealers, and IMOs. So it's really the full set of financial institution providers and all of their advisors who are serving those individual retirees and clients, investors.
Yeah, and I'm curious, like, how's adoption changed over the last year when people have all been working from home?
Yeah, it's certainly the pandemic was just a horrible thing for the world and the country. But for certain aspects of business and industry, it actually accelerated some things. And there's a number of those. And in our technology platform and many technology platforms certainly were a benefit of an accelerant that came from the need to work from home, the need to work more efficiently. As people work from home, getting access to information was a little easier in an office, right? You could get to the information, but now having effective portals and be able to get information, analyze information, simply just became paramount. So the adoption we saw grow fairly quickly, it was occurring anyways pre-pandemic. The pandemic certainly accelerated it. And now I think we're on a path that you're not really turning back from that. We've just shortened the timeline a couple years from the pandemic of what path we were on, and it's just really that we're seeing that adoption continue to grow.
Have you seen it similar for the client space? So some of the individuals we speak to talk about how they've seen the pandemic or working from home impact how they're interacting with clients. Have you seen it the same way that you've just described with the advisor front?
Absolutely. I think advisors themselves have to be much more flexible, if you will, and more creative in how they're interacting with clients and things like this. I mean, their advisors probably didn't originally envision they would be doing most of their client meetings through Zoom calls and some of those pieces, but it certainly has changed that. And with the technology, you can get access to it and see information very quickly, share information with clients very quickly, almost easier than you could in a conference room setting, if you will, and having clients come into the office. So these tools are enabling the advisors to more effectively deliver information to their end clients. And let's face it, when we look at the retirement space, to get products that are the most beneficial to those end clients, sometimes there has to be a little bit of complexity in that product in a very low rate environment to make them work. And how you display and communicate that product simply, and technology really helps that. Mm-hmm. It used to be as easier to just have, you know, in a bank CD and here's the rate. Well, products have a little more features than that today to be most effective for those end investors. And I think the technology really enables providing that information in a fairly simple way to those clients rather than a large, you know, 80-page prospectus or something. You can get to the real information that's beneficial for them much quicker.
Yeah, tell us, how do annuities and retirement planning fit into your platform?
Absolutely. Well, you know, our platform's very objective in that, you know, we're a two-sided market platform. In essence, there are the buy side, all the advisors that are using the products for their clients, and then the sell side of the manufacturers, insurance carriers, et cetera. And we're objective because it's not one type of product or one carrier. Everything is available there so that the folks that are accessing the annuity products, let's say, it's a very objective platform and it adds a lot of transparency. So what you're really doing is able to quickly and automatically filter down and analyze an individual client's situation and try to find the best products and solutions for them from a broad universe. Like I said, that was a much more manual process. And so you can now come with a client with a much broader potential list of choices, but clearly articulate the one and two that make the most sense to them. So we're really helping get that information and transparency to all of the product sets to those other investors.
Yes. How much of retirement planning will be, or I should say retirement products of the future, Tim, do you think are going to be products versus technology-driven solutions? Are we going to build the next generation of product that's going to solve everybody's needs, or do you think the future is going to be? I meet with an advisor who has a process and a platform that's going to sort of manage my decumulation phase, you know, over the next 20 years. Or some combination of both.
I think in the near term, I think you're right. It's a little bit of a comment. In the near term, advisors are really replacing some of the ways they did things before with some more automated technology. And as the technologies continue to advance, we're seeing, you know, we work in structured products and annuities, these products for those retirees. You're seeing the more customization and flexibility that you're really building and designing the product. And I think that's that next wave. You're seeing much more customization of a product in addition to just facilitating getting that product to them. And I do think that's the direction of how this moves. I joke all the time that some of these product sets in the day, they were just run through spreadsheets and emails. How did you get them and communicate them? And it was a very, very manual process. And we've moved to a much more automated platform. And the expectation of that, I think, is only going to continue to grow. So I do think going forward, you'll see much more choice, more customization, more flexibility within a given product to design features that match your specific needs.
So you mentioned direction, and some of the background we have is, you know, you started as a Cincinnati startup, and now you've moved to be a global market player. Talk to us a little bit about how, you know, U.S. market leader in structured product volume and some of the markets that you've recently entered.
Sure. Yeah, it's been an interesting couple of years. Right. You know, yes, we're based in Cincinnati, Ohio, but even in my days in wealth management, always worked with all of the investment banks of Wall Street and firms of that. So when I really started working that, you know, we're a cloud-based technology. We are connecting a lot of the Wall Street investment banks as plus insurance carriers from all different parts of the company to institutions throughout the United States. But because of that technology, it was fairly easy to follow that same recipe, if you will. Our strategy of being a buy-side skew, what does the client really need? What does the advisor need? That resonated very well. We expanded into Latin America in the second half of last year, have seen a significant growth in that space and just continuing that recipe right into Europe. I mean, we opened an office in January in Zurich, Switzerland. We're seeing very good growth across Europe. And I joke about this sometimes when we look at that. Sometimes in the US, we have a little bit of a myopic view that we are the only ones with baby boomers. Well, the baby boom came after World War II, and by definition, World War II was a world war. So there are baby boomers throughout the world, and there are a lot of countries in Europe have that same demographic who need these same things. So we're just following that recipe right into some of these other geographies, and and seeing a very similar response and result from adoption and growth.
So I have to ask, as you tread across different geographies, does the recipe change at all?
There are always, well, I think that's one of the benefits of technology. And I think Luma's differentiators are we're very objective and buy side, but our other big differentiators were we're very customizable and flexible. There are differences in culture. There's a little bit difference in the products themselves and how they work, how people like to access them. And what I've learned, and I've never met two firms that view the products exactly the same way. So rather than trying to force the square peg in the round hole, we made the technology configurable enough for that a given client can really match their need. That's been paramount to being successful in other geographies and other product sets. So that has worked fairly well. Yes, there are some differences in the different geographies, but we're really focused on a product category of those kind of like, complex non-liquid alternative investments, if you will. They all have some very similar themes. They're hard to price, hard to trade, hard to value, hard to get ongoing life cycle support. All of those things are common themes, and they really leverage across those. As long as you have a little bit of flexibility in customization of your platform, you can deliver that service pretty well in a given geography.
Yeah, and maybe throw your question out a little closer to home. Tell us about Cincinnati. What's Cincinnati like to start a business and launch a startup?
It's been very positive. I've actually lived in a lot of different cities throughout the US, although I've been here for 20 years now, so it's an adopted hometown. But we've added a lot of staff over the last couple of years, and I've been very, very pleased that we've been able to find talent locally and attract talent to Cincinnati. People don't always think about it, but it's one of those typical, as I always say, those Midwest medium-sized city on a river. They all have a similar feel. Cincinnati, Pittsburgh, in Indianapolis, and it's really very, very good culture. And we've been very pleased with it, be able to find the talent that we've been looking for. It's a great work ethic. It's been very pleased. So while we do have an office in Zurich and an office in New York, we try to put the vast majority of our folks here in Ohio, and plan to continue to do that. And it's worked pretty well.
Well, I see the banners everywhere. I live just outside of New York, so there's a big Move to Ohio campaign going on, and it's made the local news. Like, why is Ohio trying to pull everybody from New York
I'm
to
glad they're
Ohio?
doing that because we moved a couple people from New York to Ohio, which sometimes is a difficult sell, but during the pandemic that actually helped a little bit as well, right? People were much more willing to say, hey, I don't really. I'm not even able to go into the city. So we have a. It's a good cost of living. It's a good quality of life, and it's just a really good culture here for our company in the city.
Yeah, well, through our incubator as well as our company, we've really tried to cultivate a lot of either startups and or agents and advisors who really, see the sort of evolution of this digital environment as an opportunity, not a threat, and find the ones who've embraced it and give them tools and opportunities with our products to work with it. What's the agent or advisor of the future look like? Like, can you, if I've got a practice 5 years from now, I'm on your platform. What does my business look like?
Again, it's an interesting question, right? There's what does the age of the advisor look like, and what does the age of the end client look like, right? So if you look 20 years from now, 5 years from now, or 20 years from now, right, you're going to see a different demographic. One of the things, speaking to the latter part first, the end investor, I think when you look at these retirement solutions, right now a lot of folks think of baby boomers and that set. However, what we really learned, the people who grew up and experienced 9/11 in 2001 that were even younger have a very conservative mindset, and I from an investment standpoint. And I think that is true of millennials. Now you have people growing up through this pandemic period. I think you're going to have a very conservative investment mindset for a very long time. So products that have some protection, some security in them, like the retirement products, I think are going to continue in that base. So the demographic will obviously go down in age, but I don't think the need for that conservative client investment product is going to change. I think it could just continue to grow. The advisor themselves, the age of the advisor is obviously going to change over time. Obviously, the average advisor age is higher than most people would think, and probably what most things when you look at the industry would be beneficial. So I think as that advisor just naturally becomes younger, as more people enter that workforce, that group is going to even further accelerate technology. We've been fairly good in getting some of the advisors, even that ones that have been in their careers for a very long time. They've had to adopt technology in the work from home environment, and the folks behind that will just be it'll be just normal place. That's just how they operate. So, long answer to a short question, but I think both the end investor and the advisor, they obviously will be a little younger, but I think the adoption of the product set and the technology are both going to continue to grow, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's I'll agree with you. These advisors surprise you. You know, we have one advisor who's the big one for our company. Been in the business for 40 years. Paul, I do everything on with my pen, pad, and paper. I'm a napkin type of seller. Oh, but what do you like most about what you're doing? Oh, I love your online chat because I come in there and I get on online chat on your website and I get all this information every day and I know them and I love, don't take it away. Wait a second. Okay. Sometimes, behavior is not at least rational. It's rational to the person, to the advisor. It may not be rational to me.
And I think we're all advisors, and everyone's trying to do more with the amount of time they have. And if you look at an advisor, if they manage their client base, if you can use technology effectively, if you make it simple enough, I think so, sometimes technology is made too complex for folks. I think the key, I've said this a couple buzzwords I always use, that the key to financial services is taking complex issues and explaining them in a simple way. And I think technology is the exact same thing. Technology can be very complicated, but if you can make it very simple for the advisor to use, what you've in essence done is allow them to handle many more clients than they could otherwise with the same amount of time. And that's beneficial for everyone. And I think people, when they look at that, I think that's becoming more understood and accepted, partly because as people work from home, a pen and paper to, draw something on a napkin with your client when they're not in the room with you is really hard to do. So we've had to operate differently. And I think that's been very beneficial.
Yeah, it's been interesting, right? So even from a team perspective internally, when we've been trying to collaborate through a screen, we've found pieces of technology, as you mentioned, that can help make it easier for us. So for example, we use Mural, right? And it's an online whiteboard where it's essentially a virtual napkin, right? So go on, share your ideas, write back and forth. And Tim, I'm curious, have you found a piece of technology during the pandemic or within the last year or so that you wish you had about 5 years ago? Something that's just made it easier. It could be easy as like a note taking.
Yeah, we one of the things is we work with a lot of firms, and we'll do a lot of video calls and such. We in essence have every single screen sharing video platform you can think of because different firms use different. They only let certain things through their firewalls, so you end up having all of them, from GoToMeeting to WebEx to Zoom to Slack to, so we have all of them. I think they've all been beneficial. What I've really found, quite honestly, Teams is probably one of the most beneficial things. It's got an embedded whiteboard. There's something of bringing both the interaction plus interaction to your other pieces and being able to whiteboard things has been beneficial. So just from a day-to-day use, we've done that. Of course, the other technology I think that really helps us is Luma. But because we use it ourselves to run our
Of
own
course.
thing. One of the reasons one of the reasons we built it was it was kind of to make it easier for ourselves as too to interact with our clients. You know, it's a, we're, I'm in it all day, every day. That's how I'm interacting, getting information as I'm interacting with our clients and their advisors, et cetera. So I selfishly, I would say that it's probably that's the best technology I've seen over the pandemic was is our own.
Yeah. Now, we've also, you know, speaking of advisors and sort of how they've managed through the pandemic, we've seen a real barbell effect. Either, you know, advisors who really had defined markets, a good way to meet clients, they had an established client base, they were able to flip on Zoom. I've seen them have banner years. The ones who were, you know, doing the seminars, you know, showing up at the restaurants, buying it, that was tough, or showing up at somebody's house. If you kind of flip, we go forward over the next, say, 18 to 24 months. You know, Tim, what do you think the biggest impact technology will have on advisors? Will it be, I'll be able to be more efficient, you know, see more clients? You know, if I had 200 clients, I can service, you know, 400. Is it, I'm going to be able to go national when I was only local? What do you think the biggest impact will have on successful practices in the next couple of years?
No, that's true. I think in the future, practices and the future of practice, there is in many financial products from an advisor standpoint, there is some compression of revenue. So it almost requires advisors to be more effective and be able to handle more with less. Technology can really enable that. So, you know, I do have a lot of buzzwords. I joke about it, like the advisor of the future. It can't we can't go back to where some advisors they differentiated themselves on how well they could take people out for drinks. That's not a sustainable differentiator. We really need something that you can handle more clients, that you can cover more information with them. And if pricing and spreads on products continue to compress a little bit, that just becomes that much more important. I think the end investor is also less enamored with, you know, hey, just take me out for dinner and drinks, and that's how I decide on my product. They're becoming more sophisticated themselves and expect certain information. So I think that it is going to drive the how do I handle the clients, more clients effectively, but how do I get them more information in the way they want to see it? Very quick, very seamless. And that to your last point, Paul. That does certainly open up the geographies in which you can operate. If you're doing that with technology, it lets you cover a slightly larger geographic area for sure.
So, in looking ahead the 10 to 15 years, what do you see prospects for your firm?
know, I look, you know, I think 10 to 15 years is good, but even 5, I think things are changing and accelerating so quickly. We will be in a much different spot. We, like I said, we recently expanded into Europe. Asia is absolutely next. And they're all moving in a very similar process. So I think 10 to 15 years from now, you know, our objective, my objective is, and if I look at all these technologies, is we need to continue our growth domestically, but expand geographically, but also expand into related product sets. And I know that some of the things, all of the non-liquid alternative investments, I'll call them, that they have those same features, will continue to expand into those related product categories that they have the same need. So I think 10 to 15 years from now, our business looks very global and across a broader set of products, all with that similar theme. I'm hopeful we can certainly deliver that and add value to the clients. The goal at the end of the day, I think all of us in this industry realize that some of these retirement products are very good, can be very good for end investors. The challenge is helping them get to them and utilize them. The adoption's not as high as we all know it could or should be. And that's our really end objective is how do we make it easier? How do we get the adoption up for clients to use it so they're not, if it's more transparent, they're not concerned about it. And I think if we do that 10 to 15 years from now, the product category itself will be very normal place, and I would call that a success for the industry for sure.
Yeah, well, this is great. I mean, I'll take a question Laura typically asks, just steal it, which is, why are you doing this? What drives you? You had a successful advice. It sounds like very successful financial planning practice and or business, serving a number of different clients. Why would you do something crazy like spin off a technology firm and try to take over the world?
Personally, I love business. I love how business can change things. And I was fortunate enough in the when I was in the large super bank, super regional bank space, that they let me be fairly entrepreneurial, build new product sets, build new service things, expand into de novo locations. And that's really what we're doing here. I think we can improve. I feel very firmly about the benefit of these product sets and complex product sets, and I think we can improve and change the industry. And that's what's exciting to me, right? It's that how can we really get the adoption of the product set up much higher? How can we change how firms do that? And I would like to do it. I would like American companies to operate more globally and actually be a leader in a lot of those things as well. So we're all passionate about trying to take this where we think it can go.
That's great. And Tim, if people want to learn more about Luma, what is the best way for them to reach you or reach the company?
It, just going to lumafintech.com, there's some information there. There's a lot of communication and contact there. We'll give you a demo as well, but certainly contacts. I'm happy to talk to anybody in the industry. I think that we're very partnering with folks. How do we work together to benefit end investors and their lives and the portfolio? So definitely connect with us on LinkedIn, connect with us on just our website, and we're more than happy to speak to everyone as they would like.
Hey, that's great. Well, listen, Tim, thanks so much for your time, and we'll look forward to hearing, reading more about what your company is doing. So, anyway, thanks, Tim. Thanks, Laura. Thank you for joining us.
Thank
Thank
you to
you.
both of you as well, because I think you're also helping get a change to the industry, helping people be aware of what's going on. So I think it's great that you're able to get messages out like that. So thank you.
Hey, yeah, thanks so much. And if you're listening, hey, listen to us again next week. Tell your friends, forward the links, and we will put links to Lumatech's website and Tim there if you want to look. So thanks so much, and see you next week.